2007 July, Digicel launched its voice network. I was in university at that time, and I remember coming out of my dorm room and suddenly just walking around and seeing people on devices. And it wasn't something that I was particularly used to, because at that time, very few people had mobile phones.
And this is a potential school that we might be able to put through the program.
Suddenly I had my friends coming up to me. They're like, oh, there's this new mobile company in town called Digicel, and they're selling phones for $100.
Excellent. Today is, you know, International Literacy Day too, so, oh, the kids. Fantastic.
For me, I think July 2007 marked the beginnings of what was then a revolution in terms of access.
Well, I think a lot of organizations that we've come across don't go out into the community the way we do. We go to, not we, but Serena, her team, our board members, they will go to the launch of every project we do. And I think that's what makes a big difference.
Hello. So this should be able to fit about 30 students.
When we have finished the project, we have to walk away. And establishing that they can continue without us. That's why it's very important that we spend this time in the community.
So to mark this important event, Digicel Foundation made a decision to donate a set of books.
I remember when I had to stand on the roadside with my mother, you know, whether it was raining or in the hot sun, waiting for public transport to go to the nearest payphone exchange in order to then register and then stand in the line and again, rain or sun, and make a phone call. And there was no privacy and there was no ease of communication as it were today.
I'd say PNG is the country with the most potential. Easy. You know, there's 8.5 million people here. If there was a big investment in education, oh my God, it's unthinkable what could be achieved in this country.
Brown flour, there we go, tea towel. Yes, so the Irish love their bread, and they love wholemeal bread, brown bread. Here's the flour mixed with salt and sugar. Oh, come on. Whoops. Oh, there's enough lemon juice in there. Of course, you can't use the wooden spoon anymore. That wooden spoon is okay to get it up to this kind of humbly stage. So this now is going to be a loaf of Irish bread. Well, brown bread anyway. Now when I go home, I will go down to a little village on the banks of the Shannon River called Carrigahort, and I will eat a bowl of fresh mussels. They've been opened probably in white wine, a sprinkle of lemon juice over them, lashings of Imelda's brown bread, and a pint of Guinness to wash it all down. I've got to stop talking like that or I'll start crying.
It's a story not very well told, because if you take missionaries that came to Papua New Guinea here over the last 100 years, many of those missionaries went on to educate people, and it wasn't just about spreading the word of whatever their God was, because, you know, the key thing if you wanted to have a developed country is educating people.
I did not enjoy my primary school days. I was educated by the Christian Brothers, and they were very tough. They believed that you could not teach boys unless there was an element of fear at work. And so they were very quick to use the strap and the cane to beat their kids. I never forgot that. And I certainly remembered it when I was a teacher. And I was determined that when my kids came into my classroom, they were looking forward to being there. I wanted my classes to have an element of fun and excitement and adventure in them. Marco, do you want to come in and look at some of these photos? I'm trying to figure out what year is that. Would I be 1 year old or not 1 year yet? That's me with the golden curls, and that's my big brother.
Wow, your brother was so elegant. She looks like
Gala Gardner. Are you listening, Mom? It was just part of history, and we knew that our people had been starved to death, by the English, as we didn't say the British, we said the English. We knew that the wealth of the country was being exported, while people were dying by the roadside with their mouths full of nettles or grass or whatever they're trying to eat. We knew that. Ireland was losing its young people at the rate of 50 to 60,000 a year. And according to one of the Irish newspapers I looked up this morning on the internet, the population is now officially 5.1 million. Reminding people of today who read today's newspaper, reminding them of the emigration from Ireland. And sometimes these things seem as if they just happened last week.
Tiny island of New Ireland in the South Pacific, a day of great ceremonial is getting underway. Here, 12,000 miles and half a lifetime away from his home in Ireland, John Glynn is priest, teacher, and tribal chief.
Somebody sent me a DVD of a story of an Irish priest called Father John Glynn, who lived in New Ireland, probably 30 years ago on it. I watched this DVD. I thought it was remarkable because here was a priest from County Clare in Ireland and, you know, working in the community. But what he was trying to do was to keep their traditions up. And obviously he was spreading Christianity as well.
I was always fascinated by the Gospels, the stories of Jesus and how he related to people and especially how he taught. His teaching methods were incredible. I mean, always his message was positive. It was do rather than don't. Can I say a few words to the class? Okay. Okay. Morning, everybody. I apologize for interrupting your class. How are you all doing? What are you doing anyway? What's that all about?
Parts of speech.
Oh, parts of speech. Oh, grammar. Oh, I hate grammar. Everybody hates grammar. Well, grammar seems terribly boring. It really seems terribly boring. The thing is that if you know your grammar,
It means that when you are writing in English, you can come across with great clarity. And there's going to be no mistaking the meaning of the words you use.
When Father John had come to and he had made the case to our chairman at that time that the school was experiencing huge levels of overcrowding, we saw it as an opportunity to begin working on a partnership with an urban school, because the fact that 60% of the population or so thereabouts below the age of 15, it's a time bomb if we're not able to create opportunities for them.
My name is Bernadette Ove, and as of last year, the year 2020, concluded my 42 years of teaching in the schools in Papua New Guinea.
The first four dealers of brothers from Australia came up here.
In the year 2018, all the schools in Port Moresby, the primary schools, did very well at the graded national exams, and there was a big majority of students that were eligible to continue to grade 9. And we had almost over 400 students to enroll in grade 9, and we had basically only four classrooms. Just four classrooms. It caught the attention of the DigiSoul Foundation, I think, through Father John Glynn.
So what are we looking at? This is the...
This is the new classroom building.
Yeah, we've built a number of schools and a number of projects here in Port Moresby, but that was, you know, I mean, just too easy. So we decided to go all over Papua New Guinea and develop projects in conjunction with local community leaders.
And you try and name this structure.
And then get involved in issues that were kind of touchy issues that multinationals wouldn't get involved in. For example, in domestic violence, the treatment of women. And we decided that we would take some risks in that area, even if it was detrimental, possibly in the short-term interests of our business here.
Because there's a little girl in here who's severely disabled and is normally left entirely on her own in this little house. Now we can't get in because the door is locked and nobody has a key. Oh, it's too dark in there. I want to name room Figurini, Maria, Mary.
Joyce.
Unable to protect herself, Joyce has been abused by men in the settlement, leaving her parents no choice but to lock her up when they leave for work.
Joyce, you look in doctor some of the time or not? Right? No doctor. Oh, well, that's something we have to arrange.
Father John, he's heavily involved in the community, and it's the people that are really at the lowest ebb of the economic cycle and social cycle. He is doing what social services in Europe would normally do, and there's no social services of that kind of nature here and in the Pacific region. So, you know, but there's lots of other people doing incredible work here. And they also have made a big impact.
Okay. Emi long, better ni emi stop long school.
We were blessed when we had Father John Glynn coming on board in the year 2002, because he brought that spiritual aspect and blended it into everything that we were doing in the school. And the parents were quite happy, because if you look at that way, you will see there's an abandoned building that is incomplete from the Department of Education. All the schools in Port Moresby have them.
We're now approaching a classroom block.
Yes.
That was part of a scheme. I don't know the full details of it. And the education department began building classrooms, blocks like this one, and also teachers' houses and other accommodation. This building got to this stage, and then everything came to a dead stop. This is typical of a number of cases around Port Moresby in schools. And the trouble is nothing is ever resolved. And nobody says, how do we go back to identify precisely what happened, where the money went, and who is accountable? This is part of Papua New Guinea growing up. Papua New Guinea still has a long way to go. Before Papua New Guineans develop a sense of national identity, which strongly influences their behavior and their relationships to one another. This is a huge challenge for Papua New Guinea that people don't discuss or not even aware of, the need for a sense of national identity. What does it mean to be a Papua New Guinean?
Then by me walking wool, lo disla bun. Cleaning bell blong em, panimul daibun, rousing no. Then uli stop em laramem yet dry na hila.
So this is the surgical side, and when the new building is built, there'll be like another 25 beds going out this way, because you can see this is pretty full. A lot of this is trauma. This boy's gunshot. This lady's got a broken leg. She was nearly had her foot chopped off completely. He got chopped in the arm and ruptured a number of tendons. It's unimaginable. It's unimaginable. Kompium is up in the north of Anger, sort of on the border with Madang province and East Sepik. That's been our home for 22 years now. All our kids have grown up there and where we've lived. This is our eldest daughter and second eldest, and Nicholas you've met already. Yeah, that's where I cut my teeth as a rural doctor. There was really nothing there. There was two buildings, there was one house, no x-ray or no laboratory or nothing. So
yeah, when we first came in 1999, this was the administration, the whole administration was in here. And this is the operating theatre, which I'll show you in a minute. There's a dispensary and then there's outpatients. So this was the old operating theatre,
Actually, it was also the place where they did the sterilizing. When I first came, there was a wall just here. These were our operating lights. At the beginning, there was a single light that used to hang from the ceiling, a light bulb. And it would sit right next to my head when I did the operating. And then I put these ones in, these four for the belly and the chest, and these four for each arm, because we did a lot of surgery on the arms because of the machete wounds. And we used this for the first 20 years. Thank you, Mari. Inam you can kiss him keys, lo all get a containers and check him, lo this la joiner, as they may blah by me. Me strongly suspect us. We had no understanding of this at all. All we knew was that our hospital wasn't very good and that we had to make it better. We didn't have any idea about how to go about, you know, building a hospital. You have to have a plan, not a plan for tomorrow, but sort of for the long term. So a master plan so that you can work towards that over the next 20 or 30 years so that when you build a building, you then don't 10 years later realize you've got to knock it down to make way for a different building.
People need to recognize, you know, a country has to live within its means. Although Papua New Guinea is a high growth economy, at the end of the day, the government has about $5.5 billion to spend in running the country. So in real terms, PNG does not have a lot of money to spend out of its budget for education or for health. That's why the NGO sector, Dr. Mills in the Highlands, is just so important. In some ways, he is the model of community healthcare because he went to the Highlands, then he gradually expanded on the range of services. Now it is a fully fledged hospital as such. And he runs that, and he's the main healthcare provider.
Put in a big glass day. So every morning starts like this, you know, coming around, getting the guys busy, because when you've got a big crew, you know, you want to make sure that everyone has got a job to do and that they know what they're doing and whatever. So, and then I meet with the doctors and find out what's going on there, and the day goes on from there. First time I start, I'm not got any kind of maintenance, Louis. And then this man, I'm been walk when I'm some little missionary long Western Islands, I'm be poor. So I'm been retired, and I go stop the hospital in the upside, and then me play go sit down again, and then he was the first. So that was 22 years ago. Then behind, I'm me play selecting boys blow 1-1 tribe lo year. So I'm blow 1 blow tribe, I'm blow Nadla tribe, I'm blow Nadla tribe, and then I'm me blow 1 blow white man been come. Culture is really important when you're providing a health service. If you don't understand the cultural differences, you're not going to make much progress. Engans are not known for being backward, you know, they're pretty forceful, they're very forthright in what they speak and their wishes, they will. So if you upset someone, you're going to find out about it in a big way, and they can shut you down very, very easily. Me been giving you blo you blo long walking list blo you blo lo how much tool stuff, you know, blo me long maintaining more this list, my no, blo you blo. Why you put in this la lo me? Once me present him, now me present him come lo you, and you yet savvy lo amas. One of the problems that expatriates get into in this country is that because Melanesian culture is so polite and so respectful, and so you get a lot of deferential talk, and white people think that every idea they have, everyone's agreeing with it, and it's excellent.
These guys, they need to be directed as to what needs.
But
to
secretly, you know, Melanesians are saying to themselves, you know, whatever, but they don't express that.
Story long, girlfriend long, all law, one of me and I am. Okay, finish. Yep, thanks.
Nadla doctor must come looking well now morning, I think. Nadla boy, mangi doctor. Maybe the battery went out. Let me check him again. Well, pull him, assembly you may give him to her. Yeah, I just sorry, I'm good with this thing. So Monday I'm blood Dr. Diana. Wednesday blood Mina. Friday blood Dr. Mesh. You must come now, you may check.
For the last 6 years that I've been here in Compium, I didn't have that great of an understanding about what life in Compium would be like, somewhere rural and remote, because I'd been brought up in the city, obviously. So Compium was probably the first rural exposure and that I had in my life as a doctor and probably just in general.
That you put on them, but they're not working here.
In my journey in Compium, I've come to realize that being a doctor is really about serving. I think even if I were to transition back into an urban setting, I'd still be serving my people rather than practicing medicine.
Our birthing rates are chronically low, very low. One of the reasons is that when they come here, the women often don't have anything for the babies. They don't have any nappies or anything. But then also, we found out that there was a traditional belief that if they buy anything for the baby before it's born, that actually makes it more likely that the baby won't survive.
Sometimes there is some resistance because there's fear of the unknown. And like you said, if they have like maybe lots of kids at home that they need to take care of, they may be probably less inclined to come.
She was sitting on the edge of the bed and she had severe heart failure. And then I said, okay, where are you from? And she says, well, I'm from such and such a place. Well, that place, it's on the back of the mountains. I've walked to this place, it's really a hard walk. I'm looking at her so short of breath and then I'm thinking about this walk and I'm thinking, how did you do that? Like, how did you come here? And then she didn't say anything for a bit and then she just said, slowly. You know, it's never left me, you know, that statement, because in a sense that's, you know, when you're asking how did you do all this, well, that's the answer. You do it slowly. There is a sense that doctors are starting to get into this. It's still very early, but medical students are talking about it, people are getting on social media and actually coming together, and doctors are actually going out into these places. It must now some of the years, I think. One of the year. This is a pretty standard house for most rural Engans. So there'll be a fire in the middle like this. The something burning or the ashes there, there's no usually a fence around it. So one of the things we see quite commonly is children that fall into the ashes. They get burnt on their hands. That's really common. But there's no chimney. The smoke rises to the top and slowly comes out through the grass. And as the lung tissue gets destroyed, it gets hard for the blood to go from one side to the other. So the heart eventually fails. Children under 1 year of age, the most common cause of death would be pneumonia of some kind. Was involved in a fight between two clans and he was shot in the back and he's been a paraplegic ever since that time. Bullet them kiss him you to one of them up straight. Lo here. Oh, yes. So we don't have a wheelchair for him, and even if we had a wheelchair, it's pretty hard on this terrain for a wheelchair to go anywhere. So he stays in the house. He has a catheter to drain the urine. But yeah, there's no services for paraplegic people in this part of the world, so it's a difficult life.
Can I have that torch? So
sorry, knee, bend him leg, legally. On the other side. Okay, bye. Thank you.
I come from Australia, right? So, you know, Australia's the big outback, and it's known for, you know, being remote and a big country. But in truth, Australia has 15% of people living in the rural places and 85% live in the city. In PNG, it's the complete opposite. So 85% of people live in rural areas and 15% live in town. So, you know, you would think, okay, well, that means that 85% of the resources and the doctors and the nurses will be, you know, and it's just not even close to that, not even close.
Okay, that's good. Yeah.
You know, putting it bluntly and short, for the vast majority of Papua New Guineans, healthcare is, it's an imagination, really. They make do as best they can. They occasionally may bump into medicines or some staff person that will help them, but they just suffer on their own. Nowadays, when I have medical students come to me, I force them to walk up and down these mountains, and they just say, this is the hardest thing I've ever done. And I say to them, that's, you know, I'm hurting you, and I actually intended to hurt you, because each step you're taking and gasping for breath going up this mountain, you have to understand that there's a pregnant woman who has to do that, or someone who's sick with fever, or maybe they've got a broken arm and they're in pain, and imagine them doing that.
Neng le nain walen longing le yeme. Neng lumba ging le pasil layap kel ak angkap ma.
So the grass grows on top of the water. It's got a really thick root mass that causes it to float. We do have the airstrip, but that's a lot more expensive. So we try to use the waterways as much as we can. But because it's been dry season, a lot of the grass, there's no current, so the grass just grows from the edge of the river out into the middle. Oh, sorry, Serena.
Okay.
So this is a common problem. Excuse me, I've got to go to work. This village is actually two wards. They have roughly around 3,000, 3,500 people here. They have a building for the aid post, but
it's been an empty shell forever.
It's been an empty shell as long as my family have been here. When I was a kid, I don't remember it, but I think for at least the last 30 years, there'd been no paid medical people working. So it was the same up in Samban, which is one of the main reasons why we started the clinic, because there was nobody here to do the work.
I think it's going to take some time, and it's going to take a lot of investment to improve the healthcare system here in Papua New Guinea. And that's why the not-for-profit sector, missionaries, and all these different people and organizations that we have got to know because we funded some of them, the work that they're doing is absolutely profound. It's unbelievable, using very meager resources, but they're providing top-class healthcare to local communities.
My mom and dad came back in 77. And they were the first missionaries with the group called Pioneer Bible Translators. And then from Port Moresby, my dad ended up here in Samban because of a partnership with another NGO that was already building like airstrips and infrastructure. So that's how they ended up here. The dream actually came from my dad. When he pitched it to me, he came and was like, hey, I've got this dream in Samban of having a place where people can come get educational training, medical treatment, and all of this. Dad wanted me for the construction and the mechanical skills. He wanted my wife for her educational skills because they were doing the Bible translation, but there was no one here to do literacy. So they really wanted my wife more than they wanted me because they wanted someone to be able to teach the people to read God's word in their own language, which is what my mom and dad did for 21 years.
Lord Joyce, Joyce tu inosta. I'm Noka. Suppose you like changing me go to adopted parents, you must go to Engoram. One time, true papa, na adopted papa. True papa must give him signing one blah form or say no more papa. Na give him rights la this la nada blah man na adopt him. He got form blong em.
These are some of the mothers that have come to deliver at our house karam in the past year. We opened the house karam last year with the help of Digicel Foundation. Opening this up was huge for the people. We've had so many times when we would be called to people's homes to assist in deliveries. That poses a challenge for the health workers to try to bring all the equipment necessary to assist in a labor and delivery, but in someone's private home.
Heartbeat the baby and beat good. You like Aaron? Yeah, I don't know, heartbeat the baby. Last morning, it's done, I've been Aaron.
When we first arrived, there was a local aid post, but there wasn't anybody working in the local aid post. And there hadn't been for about 15 years. And so Carrie was doing medical work just basically on our front porch because, well, you're an expat. You obviously can do medical stuff. Well, Carrie's a teacher, not a nurse. We helped because, I mean, how could we turn down people that needed help? But it just got to the point to where it was overwhelming and she couldn't deal with all. And I don't do medical stuff. If you come to me with medical problems, you are really on your last way. It's the last step before we bury you in the ground. We didn't have the backing when we first came like we do now. The current sitting member, Sali Owaipo, has been very generous to us. He's donated funding for this building, but in the last 2 years, we've treated over 5,000 patients a year at a clinic with only 3 medical staff.
By helping push water like this, mean something like making a steam butter.
We now treat people from way out of our service area. People coming from the Angoram, we've got people coming from Yangru, we've got people coming from Drekakia. We're treating people that sometimes have traveled a week, 2 weeks just to get here. We're not a high profile NGO. We're just not. We live in a small section. Our niche is, you know, so remote. But Digicel Foundation wasn't afraid to take a chance on somebody like us. If they see what you're doing is legitimate and then it's going to help the local people, they're more than happy to get on board and support that.
Sometimes people get confused that if you invest a lot of money, you get a great outcome. That's not true. You know, you can use a small amount of money and get an unbelievable impact and an outcome. I mean, European healthcare providers could learn from some of the NGOs here in Papua New Guinea on how to take meager resources and create an incredible service to the local communities that they look after.
I'm 44 now. My passport's from the US, but I've lived in PNG for 33 or 34 of those years. One of the first things we said was that we took the verse out of Genesis 3:19, talking about, by the sweat of your brow will you bring forth fruit from the land, to kind of get the idea across of no one's going to come and do this for you. We're going to have to do it ourselves.
Out of here, baby. Come on.
You don't need to be in here. Come on. There's nothing in here. All the candies.
When we first came, the idea was really to support the local schools as they existed, and that all they needed was just a little assistance from the outside, maybe a little improving the quality, a little bit of service delivery, maybe some resources that we could provide. But it became evident very quickly that that was not the only thing that was needed. What it kind of meant for us was that we got a hand in creating our own curriculum, which meant we could pick the things that we knew our students needed to know in order to be successful APMA people
of the Itsibik, be successful citizens here of our province, and give some value and give some respect and honor back into their parents and their grandparents for all the things they know how to say and do, and who they are as people. The problem is not me wanting to keep that, it's actually convincing the local people that it's valuable. They don't want the local language, they don't want to learn how to build a traditional house that is not desired here anymore. And I don't know whether that is because of media, whether it was because of an older school system that degraded the local system and the customs. I'm not sure where that's coming from, quite honestly, but that is a trend that I'm seeing with no one valuing those things anymore.
This is the house of my Kandre Bap, and she's in the middle of making the fish baskets because it's the start of rainy season, so she's getting all of her baskets ready for fishing. So what they do is they it's a trap. There's an opening to it that the fish have to squeeze into, and then there's a holding. They submerge them in the water, and they put like ants or stuff, something that the fish will eat, like bait for the fish, and then the fish swim into it, and then the opening on this end that she's finishing up right now, there'll be a wadding or something that she'll put in there to block the fish basket off. And then when she picks it up, she'll take that out and empty the contents. And so whatever fish or whatever are on the inside of it, that will be what's in the fish pot or the pot for cooking that night.
Iblo sa lainim mor pigni o sa mor bigpla kamanda ponem time ba iblo walking mor la lainim la walking la lainim mor yang pla meri. All young pla meri now all no lainim ah. Yeah, the young women don't want to learn anymore. They just use nets.
Grace we em yeah. You sa wala walking no god. No, use the net. Net's easier.
So we see in the end of this one generation.
Maybe. You put the date on the headstone for when you're born, and you put the date on the headstone for when you die, and everything in between is just represented by a little dash, but that dash is what represents your life, and what you do with the dash is totally up to you. Coming back to Papua New Guinea was not what a quote-unquote normal person would make, because there wasn't any financial gain for me here. There wasn't any advancement in my personal career, but both Carrie and I felt called that coming back here, yeah, we'd be making a sacrifice for ourselves, but how many people would benefit from that? So by making that sacrifice, maybe we could show or prove to other people the love of Christ, because if you're not using your life to better situations and people around you, then what, you know, what are you doing here?
We could have come here in 2007 and spent no money on community projects. And we probably, our business would have been successful. But I wouldn't have slept well without investing money back into community projects, into school building, into health projects and other initiatives that we have run. We built networks in 31 countries around the world. This was just a mind-blowing exercise. But what a wonderful experience it has been. Along the way, we lost an awful lot of engineers. You know, people died in plane crashes, car crashes, cerebral malaria. So there was a kind of a human element as well. But we're proud to have played a very small part, a small role in the economic development of P&G.